Okay, well, what I plan to do is a very short introduction, maybe 10 or 15 minutes. You know, Professor Zokosky has to justify the time that you are spending today, not doing art per se, but listening to some rogue scientist discuss the larger reality. So I feel obligated to say a little bit something about how this is all connected and how we actually aren't as different and aren't as far apart as it may seem. Okay, well, as you know, I'm Tom Campbell. I'm a physicist with a big toe. Hopefully, most of you have watched a few of my videos on YouTube explaining what some of my ideas are. I'm depending on that since there will be little time to explain basics during this virtual visit today. I'd like to start this virtual meetup by describing how it is that we, artists and big picture scientists, are not as different as it may first seem. Indeed, there are similarities and connections between us that may surprise you. Then, after my few introductory words, I will answer your questions about your adventures in Big Toe Land on the YouTube channel. Hopefully, most of you have been there. Or about anything else that crosses your mind. We're not restricted to talk about anything in particular. It'll be entirely open to whatever it is you'd like to talk about. Okay. Well, Professor Zokosky teaches surrealism, and no doubt a physicist addressing an art class over Skype for apparently no rational reason is by definition a surrealistic happening. On top of that, since what is surreal depends on our understanding of what is real, and my big toe theory declares that what is now considered real by the majority, that is, us and our objective physical reality, is indeed as surreal as any world where melting pocket watches ooze over the sides of rectangular solids that hang in dead trees like old celery on a hot day or a chocolate bar left too long in the sun. Indeed, I have read that the general interpretation of Salvador Dali's painting, The Persistence of Memory, is that the limp pocket watches and bizarre landscapes are a rejection of the assumption that reality is objective and deterministic. In fact, as I understand it, surrealism's main contribution to our culture is to facilitate the integration of our inner and outer worlds, to bring about a more natural balance between the objective and subjective aspects of our reality. Well, that's also exactly what I do. So, is this art imitating science or science imitating art? Or both art and science dealing creatively and logically with the nature of a reality within a culture that has become unbalanced in its perspective of what is real and what is important? If you've watched enough of my YouTube videos, you'll immediately comprehend, given what we've just said, that I and the surrealists are, at the root, soul brothers. My work expresses the exact same idea, a rejection of reality being objective and deterministic, though I arrived at that conclusion through an entirely different process called science. So when Professor Zokosky asked me to talk to the surrealism class, I thought, kindred spirits. Gee, we should easily be able to gather up a critical mass of weirdness and could have a really good time freaking out people who have so little imagination that they actually believe themselves to be normal people living in an objective reality. In my big toe, I go so far as to say that all reality is subjective. There is no such thing as an objective reality. Objective reality is only an approximation. However, it's a very good approximation when working with things that have small natural uncertainty, and a very bad approximation when working with things that have large natural uncertainty. Those activities that deal exclusively with things that have little natural uncertainty are logic-driven and called the objective sciences, such as physics, chemistry, biology, while those activities that deal exclusively with things that have high level of natural uncertainty are mostly subjective, intuitively expressed, and called art. music, painting, dance, literature, sculpture. Most disciplines contain both low uncertainty and high uncertainty components. Those with the very least uncertainty, the least subjectivity, are the hard objective sciences, while those with a moderate amount of uncertainty and subjectivity are the soft sciences. They represent people science rather than inanimate object science. The science of highly uncertain people rather than the science of low uncertainty stuff. But what am I talking about here with soft sciences? Soft sciences are things like psychology, sociology, economics, medicine, anthropology, architecture. Those with the most uncertainty, the most subjectivity, are the arts. The word uncertainty implies the most degrees of freedom, the greatest amount of unique variation within accurate, viable, or acceptable results. In other words, the results are uncertain when there are lots of variations in the output response to a given input stimulus. Artists, then, like yourselves, live in a private world that is subjective and intuitively expressed, and simultaneously in a public world that is objective and logically expressed. Well, that's enough to make artists a tad, shall we say, different, out of sync with their external culture, not quite in the mainstream, but more in sync with their internal culture, more the heart and soul of our collective existence than the head and hands. Unfortunately, it is the head and hands that go out into the unbalanced objective world to make a living, like the battery-powered robots designed to make utilitarian products, while the heart and soul stays home to decorate and inspire, while living on leftovers. Here, the symbology of leftovers represents the excess or discretionary funds of the few. So here we both are. A scientist who has derived the origins and workings of consciousness, making subjective value, meaning, and purpose a science, and a collection of artists whose job it is to create that which has subjective value, meaning, and purpose, objects that inspire as well as refresh and inform the individual consciousness. It would seem that we, you the artist and me the big picture scientists, have mutual interests and mutual goals. To help others find and then nurture their interconnectedness to something larger than themselves. To add subjective quality to lives primarily based on objective quantity. To help launch those who are ready to explore the multidimensional nature of their existence. To help them feel the truth that they are more than numbers and stuff. We, you and I, are not as dissimilar as one might think. Both art and big picture science is in the business of creating opportunity for others to experience a larger reality that transcends the limits of physical existence. In fact, big picture science, art, philosophy, and metaphysics have all found that they are more or less singing the same tune, speaking of the same basic truths from different perspectives. It is inevitable that one day, when we fully understand the reality of which we are a part, science and philosophy must coalesce into one unified understanding. To be sure, the dominant little picture science that maintains the status quo within the scientific establishment still has its head in the sand. Unfortunately, most scientists are fundamentalists. True believers in the little picture view of a universal and exclusive objective reality. However, that is changing, and we will continue to change because the truth is neither fragile nor indefinitely suppressible. So what is the likely cultural impact of this truth carried forward by your art and my big toe? Well, while art's impact is entirely subjective, the impact of big picture science has a strong objective component. Scientists today are the high priests of our cultures, our culture. They tell us what to believe, what is true, and what is not. When Fredkin's Other becomes seen by the majority of scientists as objective, as something real, our culture will change forever. Like most sudden conceptual upheavals in worldview, it is going to be a wild ride with lots of turmoil and change as we move, this time on a global scale and at internet speed, from a smaller to a bigger picture. I expect cultural changes to be bigger than the changes delivered by Copernicus, Galileo, Newton, Einstein, and Bohr and Heisenberg all put together and multiplied times 100. So that's going to be a lot of change. That's going to be something very dramatic and probably take place over what, tens of years, maybe 20s of years, rather than centuries, as we've seen before. So I guess it's fitting that after a semester of discussing weird art, you should take a little break and discuss some weird science for a change. I'll be your tour guide on this particular trip, but we'll go wherever you want to go. So go ahead, lead on with your questions.
Tom, that's an amazing introduction. You've given us a lot to think about. I think you're sensing a lot of agreement in the room. I don't know if you could see people nodding their heads, but I think, you know, we really do find a common meeting ground. Just before the conference started, we were talking a little bit about how accustomed artists are to the idea of creating their own reality. That it is a pretty comfortable concept for many artists. So I think that it's kind of remarkable that we get to have this dialogue, because I don't think the basic premise of inventing or finding or creating your own reality is quite as difficult for this group to grasp. I feel like there really is an opportunity there. And I think maybe where it's a little bit less known or more variables for us is, what does that then mean? Where do we go with some of our ideas? And this idea that there is a big world out there that is perhaps less receptive to what we have to offer, I think is something that all of us are quite aware of. So I think a lot of our struggles are about how to find our way in a world that isn't necessarily that interested in art or what we are about, but I think the basic foundation is there. So I think we're really interested in all of that.
Are you telling me that your students didn't rebel when you asked them to look at those YouTube videos? They didn't call you crazy or give you a hard time?
Yeah, they've been listening to me long enough that you seem quite sane by comparison, I think. But no, it really is exciting. And I think that, you know, having somebody from another discipline express some of the same ideas is really exciting. And I think that a lot of artists feel like science is kind of the polar opposite, or at least our culture sort of regards art and science as these two positions that have absolutely nothing in common. So it's really gratifying to hear you talk about how much we do in fact have in common. And I think that's very, very true. And I think it's a fairly recent phenomenon that those two disciplines have been considered so separate. I think in the past, you know, somebody like Leonardo da Vinci, of course, you know, he could be called a great scientist and a great artist, and that wasn't seen as, you know, contradictory paths. And I think that in the recent world, not only has the general culture sort of divided, but even the art culture has divided tremendously. There are artists that really only deal with conceptual ideas, and the idea of a physical aesthetic expression of that becomes kind of foreign. There are artists that are just dealing with linguistic construct. There are artists that are only dealing with the emotions. So it's become a very kind of fractious field, unfortunately. Mm-hmm. So I would love to see more unity, you know, in the general culture, but also in the art culture itself.
Sure.
Yeah.
Well, the tendency has been to work in smaller and smaller pictures, you know, specialize, right? And what, of course, we need, once we specialize, we get to a point where we really don't understand anything, even what it is we're specialized in. We tend to lose contact with the bigger picture. When we lose contact with the bigger picture, then even what we're doing is no longer connected, you see, to the bigger thing. So then we kind of feel sort of out of it. We're remote. We've basically taken ourselves and taken ourselves out of the larger picture. And then that's a kind of an impoverished place to be in. So much better to go the other way, to where we see bigger and bigger pictures and get more and more connected to each other and to what's going on and to how it's all connected together, as opposed to denying the connections and going off in our own, you know, little worlds where we can be masters. We can be big fish in a small pond if we if we do that. And it's better to realize that we're actually very, very small fish in a very, very big pond, and not find that objectionable. But it's kind of where we have gone with the specialization idea, kind of followed with science and technology and so on. There's, you know, you only get good at something if you specialize in it. It's very difficult to be good, you know, as a generalist. And if you are a generalist, then it's very hard to find work, because, you know, nobody's so interested in generalists any day with big ideas as they are interested with specialists and experts that are very clever in their own tiny little area, but they miss the connections with everything else. And we end up with a fragmented world. But you talked about that artists are familiar with creating their own reality. You know, the main thing, the big thing that comes with creating your own reality is that suddenly you find yourself responsible. You know, if your reality sucks and you create your own reality, well, you know, the obvious conclusion, right, is that you need to do something different. So if you know that you create your own reality, then also comes the responsibility of what it is you create. And why is it that you're creating it that way? And how can you create it in a way that you might enjoy it and like it and live in it better? So the responsibility goes with that knowledge.
That's a very interesting idea, that maybe perhaps one reason we run from some of these challenges is because, yeah, precisely what you're saying, you are responsible then. I think it's much easier if you can just blame the culture, other people, your teachers, you know, the government, whatever.
Particularly your teachers. That's a good one. Yeah.
Exactly. Boy, now you bring up some good points. Anybody else have any questions they'd like to pose or points they'd like to make? Yeah, come on up front. We're going to shift around a little bit so that the questioner is close to the microphone. This is Robin.
Hi, Tom.
Hello, Robin.
Thank you so much for speaking with us. I really...
Oh, you're quite welcome. It's going to be a lot of fun, I think, today.
One thing I wanted to say that I really got from listening to some of your lectures, being someone who's personally pretty atheist, I found it a way for me to be a lot more accepting of other religions, because you were phrasing it as a way of tapping into a higher consciousness and kind of this need to open up to how everyone individually has certain ways that they do that, and that it's important to respect that. So for me, I felt kind of this calming sensation of not having to, you know, convert everyone to a certain enlightenment that I felt, because they were benefiting their own way from what they were doing. And the question that I had for you today is actually a little bit more neuroscience related. We've been talking about that a lot in the class, and I was curious, just because a lot of the framework you set up with was about building a higher level of consciousness throughout your lifetime, and some brain damage can really alter a personality where that personality would suddenly seem less enlightened, but it's a result of frontal lobe damage, that suddenly someone's a lot more aggressive and causing harm to others and, you know, increasing entropy. So would you explain that by a certain, that's kind of the rule set that we're operating in, and that person might still be on mm-hmm. and sort of a path to higher consciousness?
Sure. Well, the thing that's confusing is kind of the connection between brains, you know, and brain just being a part of the body, you know, between your body and your brains and consciousness, you know. So here we are in these, you know, gorgeous little bodies, right, that we walk around with and are used to, and yet you read my work or you look at it on YouTube, and I'm talking about consciousness, and getting these two together is a big issue for a lot of people as far as understanding. Here's the way to look at it: is, you know, we start this virtual reality that we live in, and I'm going to just guess that you already know some of the terminology, so I'm going to skip a lot of definitions, but we're living in this virtual reality. This virtual reality is different than the virtual reality in, say, The Sims, in that the one in The Sims was programmed. The virtual reality in that we live in evolved. So I say in my lectures that we started with the big digital bang, okay? Well, that's when somebody threw the run switch in the computer room, and the simulation started. And that simulation, of course, was a simulation of a whole lot of energy in a little tight spot, and it expanded, and as it expanded, you know, the rule set had gravity in it, and the gases coalesced, and you got planets and suns, and et cetera, et cetera. And then you had a planet like this one where we evolved us. So here we are at the end of this process, and this is all a big simulation. Okay, now the simulation takes place and evolves according to a rule set, which is kind of like our science. It's the rules of how energy can exchange between things in the simulation. Okay, now, so what does this have to do with brains and consciousness? You are consciousness, yet you're living in this simulated reality, and therefore you're restricted in this simulated reality from how you interact, how you share energy, how you just how you interact in your reality, okay? What you can perceive, what you can do, all of that is restricted by this simulation, this rule set. So the rule set says that you probably, you know, we evolved this brain, and this brain allows us to do certain things, and we evolved this body, and the body allows us to do certain things. We can't jump 20 feet in the air. Why? Because according to the rule set and this evolved simulation, if you will, the beings that are us, that evolved to be like us, can't jump 20 feet in the air. We can't learn quantum mechanics and advanced math in an hour. We just can't do that. Our brains can't do that sort of thing. So we're limited. So the simulation is basically can be seen as, our bodies can be seen as representing constraints. Okay, so you have a brain. That brain is a product of evolution, which means it's in consonance with the rule set, and it only allows certain things to happen. It's a constraint on you as consciousness when you're evolved in this virtual reality game. So now someone comes up and hits you over the head with an iron pipe, and now your brain is damaged here, and according to the rule set, you can do less. You maybe can no longer walk. Maybe you're paralyzed on one side of your body. These things now, you have more constraints than you had when it was only the constraints by the rule set from the evolution. Now you have added to that the constraints from being hit with the iron bar. So that does not affect your consciousness. Your consciousness is still the same consciousness with all the same capabilities. But the ability of that consciousness to express itself in this virtual reality game is now constrained in a new way. So we have to separate these two concepts of consciousness. We have a concept of consciousness that I've just been talking about. I'll call that big C consciousness. And then there's also this concept of consciousness we have that's little C consciousness. That's our awareness. That's you sitting there, me sitting here. We're talking each other out of this little C consciousness. That's our local awareness in this virtual reality. That's the constrained big C consciousness, constrained by the rule set that runs this virtual reality game. You see, when you have Sims players or World of Warcraft players, they are constrained by what the rule set allows them to do. You know, they can't walk through walls. They can't, you know, my daughter played Sims, and she had this thing where she'd put the kids in the swimming pool, then pull up all the ladders and see what happened. You know, well, they drowned, you know. I don't know if you did that when you were little girls or not, but you know why she did that? She wanted to decorate her front yard with gravestones. And so, well, that's how you do it. You put your kids in a swimming pool and pull up all the ladders in Sims. I know, it sounds ghastly, doesn't it? She actually turned out all right. But anyhow, that's, you know, there's certain things that the Sim players, the rules they have to obey. You know, they can't leap 20 feet in the air either because they're kind of modeled after us. So there's this rule set that they have to abide by in the game, that they can't do things other than that. Well, we're like that too. So here we are, big C consciousness, connected to the larger consciousness system, but where a subset of that is constrained to this rule set. So we do lose function if we have brain damage. We do have to interact with all the rules and all the accumulation of stuff and choices that we make here in this virtual reality, and we're limited to certain things. So that's kind of the virtual reality, big C consciousness, little C consciousness, brains, and how all of it fits together. Hopefully that made sense to you. That's a big discussion that we could have for about 3 hours, and we just put it into about 5 minutes, so it makes it a little harder to understand when it's that compact. But feel free to ask more questions if I haven't answered your question.
Yeah, I think that did a good job answering it. I think I was struggling with that idea of differentiating someone's personality from their consciousness.
Yeah, their personality is local. That's part of their little C consciousness. That's what they've developed here in this virtual reality frame. Okay, and that's kind of a local little C consciousness. But what that is a big C consciousness being constrained to the choices that are available here, to the things you have to do here, to if you get hit with an iron bar, you know, now you're paralyzed on one side and dealing with that, you know, dealing with all the other things that happen in your life. So you make choices here because, you know, that's what we're here for. You know, we make choices. We're here to grow up. We have all these opportunities. We make the choice, and then that changes us. We become different people because of the choices we make. We wander off and become artists instead of lawyers or something else because of all the, you know, the choices that we make. And we end up being different. We grow, hopefully, reduce our entropy, become higher quality beings. But that's the constrained us in the virtual reality game. So that's, you know, and that's what we're here for. When we're in this game and make these choices, that gives us a set of constraints and rules by which we can interact profitably and learn. There's feedback. You know, it's not, it would be hard if we didn't have this virtual reality. It would be really hard to grow and change and make choices. It would be like you were on in a chat room with, 5,000 other people and no rules. You know, anybody can say anything to anybody. You know, you don't know what's true, what's not. There's very little feedback that you can rely on. You don't really learn much in that situation. You may be entertained, but it's not. You need more consistency in the feedback. You need more certainty in what's going on and how you're interacting in order to learn and grow. So that's why we need to do it inside of this constrained virtual reality, because that's actually the fast track. If you're outside of this virtual reality, that's the slow track as far as evolving your personal quality of your consciousness.
Well, thanks so much, Tom. Thank you for answering my question so thoroughly, and again for coming and speaking to our class. I really appreciate it.
Oh, you're quite welcome, Robin.
How do we apply or use what you would call big C consciousness? In other words, my question is the human realm limited to little C consciousness? And I want to know what the difference as it applies to us, rather than just a theoretical difference, but a difference that is applicable to us between the rule set and reality. Is that too random?
Well, I'll just take hold of it and see what I do with it. And if I don't do very well, you can ask it, differently. But it's like the little C, big C consciousness thing. Okay, so here we are, and we're little C consciousness, and we're interacting, and we're in this virtual reality game, and we are growing based on our choices that follow our intent. All right. Well, what about big C consciousness? While we're here, as in this virtual reality game, can we experience the big C consciousness? What's the advantage? Can we get into that game, or are we just stuck here in little C consciousness? There's lots of points there I'd like to make in that. One is, yes, you can escape this virtual reality, and you do that by escaping through, of course, your consciousness, your mind. Your mind is the doorway, and the process for learning that usually starts with meditation. Meditation is just an exercise where you become familiar with your own consciousness, and from meditation you can learn to then, travel. All these words aren't quite right. They're all metaphors, but you can get around in the larger consciousness system. You can access the databases I talk about. You can look at the probable future. You can interact with the past. All the data is there for you to interact with. There's lots of things you can do. You can use your mind to heal or to hurt. You can use your mind to help you focus on what's important and what's not. So there's a lot of things you can do if you are able to have a facility for getting around and focusing your intent in the larger consciousness system as opposed to just inside the virtual reality system. But now, on the other hand, is that important? Is it something that you can't, that you have to do in order to grow up? And the answer to that is no. You're here in this little C consciousness to experience. That's what you're here for. And that's where the rubber meets the road, and that's really the fast track to growing up. So all you have to do is make every choice that you make be a good one, and the rest of it will all take care of itself. You don't have to go out of body. You don't have to remote view. You don't have to be able to heal people with your mind. None of that is necessary to your growing up here and for fulfilling your mission for your lifetime, your existence here. On the other hand, it will help you understand on a first person, non-intellectual, more intuitive way this larger reality that we're in. Because you can hear me talking about it, and you can read books about, remote viewing and out of body and so on, and that's, that's nice, interesting stuff. But until it's your experience, it can't be your reality. When it is your experience, and you are able to perform experiments there, gather data that otherwise you couldn't have, in other words, do evidential things, then suddenly you realize this is real, and it makes sense to you. When it's just intellectual, it can't make but so much sense to you. It's just theory. So what does getting out of the larger consciousness do? It helps turn theory into personal experience. And if you can do things there that are evidential, then it'll give you confidence that this theory actually is actual. It's not just make-believe theory, but it's actually there. So for people who have a need, particularly left brain people who need logical process, it's good for them to get this experience. Right brain people don't need logical process. They know how it all works, and they don't need to go out and experiment or have anything happen like that. They just know it. They feel it in their bones. They know that this is a larger reality and all the pieces are connected, and they kind of get the idea of it without having to go experience. So for the left brain, it's a way to make it real. Otherwise, it's always hypothetical. But hypothetical isn't bad. As you know, I always talk about being open-minded but being skeptical. in a way, that's what a hypothetical, you know, theory is. It's something that you're open-minded about, you consider it, but you're skeptical. You don't know if that's real or not. That's not a bad place to be in. This idea that we have that you either have to believe it or not, you know, and we're pushed that way internally. We want to know, can I believe this? That's the burning question. Can I really believe it, or, you know, can I not believe it? You know, is this guy nuts or what? You know, that kind of a question. And we all kind of strive for that, can I believe it or not? And that's the wrong question. We shouldn't be asking, can you believe it or not? That pushes us into a space that's not useful, because if you get to the point and you say, I believe it, well, now you kind of believe something. You believe maybe what other people have told you or what you've read. How valuable is that? You see, that's not really going to take you anyplace important. Or if you say, I don't believe it, it's all a bunch of garbage, it's the same thing. Now you've locked yourself out from ever learning more. So both places, you kind of lock yourself into a subset of information, or you lock yourself out from all the information, but in either case, it's not useful. So the thing to go, the way to approach it, the way to go here is to say, well, maybe it sounds like it might be interesting, but I'll be skeptical about it, and I'll be open to it, and I'll try to get some evidence, maybe, if I'm inclined to evidence, if I'm left brain. If I'm not inclined to evidence, then you get that evidence through your intuition, through your knowing. So it's better not to feel pushed to, you know, to get into that big C consciousness. If I could just get in there and go out of body and go discover something and then find that it was true, you know, then I could believe it. All of that is the wrong approach. It doesn't matter. You don't need to believe it or disbelieve it. Just be open-minded and skeptical. That will take you further than believing or not believing it.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I was married to a manic depressive schizophrenic for a couple of years who ended up committing suicide. And I was wondering, have you dealt with this? Have you been asked to deal with this and setting up some kind of an anchor for these people? Because their set of rules are always variable, you know, depending on where their chemistry is. Mm-hmm. And have you dealt with these kind of people? And I know this isn't about art so much, but...
Well, I have dealt with some people like that, and there's several reasons why you can end up schizophrenic, paranoid, other kinds of issues. It can be, sometimes people are diagnosed paranoid just because they have a kind of a bleed through to other reality systems and a larger reality, and they are getting this data. And in that case, you can talk with them and find that out. That's easy to fix, because then suddenly, you know, you can help them separate the two and understand the difference between this reality and that reality, and how can they learn to separate it and know you're not crazy, you just have this extra channel operating. But that's usually the minority. The others are basically biochemistry has gone awry. You know, the brain, the rule set requires, you know, it's the chemistry, it's the biology, all that's part of the rule set. And a lot of that rule set, as it's developing, particularly in utero, there's lots of opportunities for randomness. You know, the way things just happen to go together, and the way things just happen to go together, you know, turn out that you're, you know, pituitary gland isn't secreting the way it's supposed to, or some sort of thing. So now you aren't normal anymore, you know, and your perception isn't normal. Maybe you're autistic, or maybe you're paranoid, or maybe you're schizophrenic, and you're not functioning the way most people function. Well, you know, these things are statistical. So you have this big bell-shaped curve, and most of us fit under the fat part of the curve, because that's where most of these combinations and permutations of possibilities go together, within this fat part of the curve. But there's always a few people that are out there under the tail of this, you know, statistical curve that are unusual. You know, they're in the 0.1% or the 0.1%. They have these rare issues to deal with. with people like that, it's really very difficult to, well, here comes my buddy here. Say hello to Max. This is Max, and he likes to sit in my lap. Yes, it is it's a Maine Coon cat. Yeah, it's a 20-pound cat, so you kind of have to do whatever he wants. So anyway, it is hard to deal with that. Sometimes I have found that the imbalance that the people are dealing with is a result of fear. It's neither the first that I said. It's neither that they're getting kind of an open comm link to something they don't understand, nor is it the fact that their biology was scrambled with a little, you know, random action back earlier in the development time, but the fact that they have a lot of fear, and sometimes they come in with that fear. It's just the way they are. It's where their consciousness is, and that fear begins to manifest as mental illness and these things. And if you can get to the source of the fear, sometimes you can at least help those kinds of mental illnesses. What happens is when people have fear, their reality gets smaller. They start to live in a smaller and smaller reality. Kind of the last question that we were talking about, you can live in a small reality or a big reality. If you live in a really big reality, you're probably aware multidimensionally, and you live in something much bigger than just this virtual reality. Okay, you live in a multidimensional existence. You're aware in many different reality frames, and you can visit in these frames. You can even do it simultaneously if you like. But that's a very big reality. As people get more and more fearful, let's say somebody who's suicidal, their reality gets smaller and smaller and smaller until there's nothing in it except just that terrible thing that they are so obsessed with. And that's all there is in their reality anymore. And you try to point out to them, yes, but look over here at this really good stuff that's in your life. You know, look at your relationships or your children or this and that, and they can't see it. It's like, yes, but, you know, and they're right back here. They can't interact with that reality because their reality now is so small and so hemmed in. It has only these awful things in it. These are the people that often end up committing suicide because their reality is just so tiny. And one of the ways you can work with that is to just pry it open a little bit. And you can't do that by telling them what it is that's wrong with them and why it is that they're, you know, that their reality is too small. That just makes them worse, not better. You have to pry it open a little bit at a time, just a little bit at a time. And sometimes that works, and sometimes they're so committed and so obsessed with these singular issues that you can't pry it open. So there's a lot of reasons that one could end up like that. It's hard to say exactly why anybody's just like that unless you spend some time talking with them and seeing, you know, where is it coming from. Most of the time, the biochemistry is faulty, sometimes because of fear and sometimes because that's just the way the cookie crumbled when all those pieces were formed and went together. And there's not a whole lot that one can do about it. So why are they here? And why, you know, why would you come in with that kind of a thing? Well, one, you didn't necessarily plan it. It's just chance. You know, everything isn't planned. Sometimes things just work out that way. But the people around them, it's a challenge to them. Like, you know, your husband was a challenge to you. You know, you learn something from it. You learn how to deal with things that otherwise you wouldn't. You grow up in certain ways when you have to deal with a person like that, particularly if it's a loved one, if it's a child or a parent or a spouse or something like that. So it's very educational for the people around them, very difficult for the people around them. But in hindsight, you'll see that it's also educational. You grow from that experience. It's not all... you know, it's not all bad. Some of it actually challenges you to grow up in ways that you wouldn't have before. And the person themselves, well, you know, we talk about, you know, suicide's a terrible, awful thing. And you know, I guess even some religions make it, a sin or something. But basically, you're here to learn and to grow. And if something goes wrong, and you exit early, that's probably a good thing. You know, it's probably what you need to do because you got off to a really bad start on this experience packet. You know, might as well learn what you can learn from it. And when you get to the point you can't learn anymore from it, you might as well get a different experience packet. So we need not to take quite the heavy kind of, oh no, how awful, and how, you know, we can get into a really heavy trip over bad things like that. But we, you know, need to maybe say, well, you know, that sometimes happens. And when it does, it's good to, you know, to start over after you've milked what you can get out of the situation, and don't take it personally. And, you know, it's like, it's not your fault. You know, it's just, it's life. We deal with it the best we can. We learn from it and we go on. So in that sense, it takes some of the heaviness out of those kinds of horrible experiences. Did I get anything near your question?
Yeah, and I could identify with a lot that you shared. I felt like I grew a lot. I can identify this in other people in my life just because I lived with this man for 2 years. So,
right.
Yeah, it's
kind tough, of a lifelong though, isn't it? It's really tough. It's a hard way to learn, yeah. But you do
he
learn a lot.
He just never had the ability to choose and stick with it. Stick with his choice. There was always, his life never seemed to stay in one spot. His feet never were in one spot that he could tend to grow. And he was always shifting. It was never stable. So anyway, thank you for your answer.
You're welcome.
Hi, Tom.
Hello.
This actually kind of goes back to Peter's question, the video cut out right at the point that I really wanted to hear about the you create your own reality thing. I've read a lot of Jane Roberts, and I was I learned a lot from the Sunday lecture, the Calgary lecture, where someone asked a Jane Roberts question about time. And you said that Jane Roberts had kind of got it wrong, but was hinting on the right thing. And I was wondering if maybe you could, Peter's question about the rule set being static, like that's something that I've thought about a lot. Like, is there a way to actually change the laws of physical reality? When I was reading a lot of Jane Roberts, I assumed that there was that walls only appeared to be solid because we believed that they were solid. And if you change your belief, then you can actually change physical reality, I guess individually or as a culture. And I'm wondering what your interpretation is of this.
Well, yes, we can. You know, we have rules that we live by, and we can kind of violate our own rules under certain circumstances. But it's not just as simple as we all have to agree that we can walk through walls and then we can do it. You know, it's not, it doesn't work as easily as that. And there's another wrinkle in it. It's a thing that I call the psi uncertainty principle. And that is that anytime you break a rule, if you break it in front of others, or if you and a small group of people break that rule, there has to be deniable plausibility in the society at large. In other words, people, if you go out and say, hey, three of us all believed that we could walk through walls, and we did, you know, and here all three of us did that, we all swear that it happened, and here's the brick wall we walked through, really, honest. Of course, there's a lot of plausible deniability. Everybody else would look at you and say, yeah, right, you know, what were you guys drinking, smoking, or, you know, or taking when that happened? You're just pulling our leg, and there's obviously deniability. There's no way, you know, you're not going to prove that. So you set up your cameras next time, and you have cameras inside the wall, outside the wall. You have it on a remote feed. Those cameras are being shown to a big monitor to 1,000 people someplace else, and you get it all set up to where there is, you know, you would have to be believed, and guess what happens? You can't walk through the wall anymore. You see, you can't. You no longer can do that because you've taken away the plausible deniability. Why is that? because the reality that we have here has a purpose, and that's for us interacting with each other and growing up, and that the button-down rule set that we have gives us the structure with which we can do that best. If we start allowing the rules to be broken kind of by anybody, anytime, then suddenly we're in a funhouse, schoolhouse. There's nothing you can rely on. It's very difficult to learn in that situation. There are parts, both coasts of Africa, where people, everybody there pretty much knows that you can modify reality with your mind. And there are people there who, shall we say, it's like a confidence game in that you pay me money and I won't make you sick. You know, instead of using the mind to heal, they can use the mind to hurt. And that's a common sort of thing in those cultures. And it really makes it difficult to learn, to grow in those cultures. It's much more difficult than it is in our culture. So when you run into people and they say, oh, that's a bunch of bull, I don't believe all of it. Well, there's a purpose for that. They're not ready yet. They haven't had the experiences, and they haven't had the experiences because they're really not ready to deal with the experiences. You don't want to grab that person and shake them and say, well, look, listen to me. You know, I can, you know, you need to see it this way. They don't. It's better that they don't see it that way. So, yes, you can change the rules, but there are limits to how you can change them and when you can change them. And basically, you modify the rules most easily by modifying the reality. And that's where it comes to, you create your own reality. One of the ways you do this is you can modify the future probable, you know, the future probability of any event happening. So there's n things that can happen. These are all potential things. So they're all possible. And some of them are more probable than others. And you can use your intent to change which ones are more probable than others. So you can modify the probability of something occurring. That's the way one heals with their mind. They modify future probabilities with their intent. So you can do that sort of thing. And all of that is mostly subjective to you, though it's objective in its result. So you use your mind to heal, or you use your mind, like in that Sunday that you looked at, to remote view and see what the picture I was looking at or whatever. Well, you can always jump up and down and say, I got it. You know, I got the picture perfectly. And there's deniable, it's deniable. Somebody else can say, you're just saying that. You just want people to think you got it. You see, so you can violate the rules, but mostly you violate them in subjective space rather than objective space. But that's fine, because you as a consciousness really are just subjective, and our objective reality is only a hallucination anyway. So where it really counts most, you can make the reality suit yourself in many ways, suit your growth. But now if you start making it suit yourself in ways to suit your ego, you will find that it'll probably backfire. And a thing called unintended consequences will probably bite you. Does that give you some answer?
Yeah, definitely. Good. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Hi, Tom.
Hello. I call you by a name, but you didn't tell me. So.
You know, I am also Robin. Just to.
Oh, another Robin.
Yeah, Robin.
It must be springtime.
Robin S. this isn't so much a question as it is kind of a just giant gap in my understanding of everything that you've said. And I watched the lectures right up almost to the end of Sunday. And from what I saw, you only touched briefly on it on Saturday. And that is kind of the role of the non-human, theoretically non-conscious parts of our world. You know, if I know you talked a little bit about the tree in the forest, and if there's a tree in the forest and no one's there to hear it, does it make a sound when it falls? And your answer is, what tree?
It doesn't fall.
Yeah.
It just changes state.
Okay, yeah. and how that would be affected if there was a squirrel in the tree, or if there was, so just like kind of there's a grasshopper in the tree, and then kind of going on down the line. And there's something, I think it may be that I'm just not quite understanding how you're proposing this, but there's something that doesn't sit quite easily with me about kind of going down a nickel and diming about how we're divvying up conscious and who counts and who doesn't, and, you know, what's happening at the bottom of a deep sea abyss, or does it not exist just because we're not there, you know? Mm-hmm. Can you just comment a little bit on that topic?
Well, sure. You know, the way that works, you know, you go into the woods, right, and then you see the tree, and the reason you see it is because it's probable that it's like that. That's how you see it that way. Now, let's say there are squirrels that live in that woods, and those squirrels are sentient beings. You know, they have consciousness, they make choices, and they're sentient. So what you'll see in that woods will have to take their consciousness in account, so that if they live in a hollow tree, that you know, if there are squirrels in that woods, and when you go in, it's probable that some will be in your area that you would see them. And this, it's probable that there's a bunch of them living in a dead tree there. Then you're not going to go in and live in the same reality they're living in and not see each other. They're going to notice you, and you're going to notice them. In other words, consciousness at all levels has to be included in the process, so that the total process has to be consistent with the rule set and historically consistent for all consciousness. So the more consciousness you have around, then the more constraints you have on exactly, you know, the kinds of things that you can see or not see. So that's, you know, what should we say? In computer games, you notice not every character in a computer game is conscious, right? A lot of them are conscious characters, but some are just what they're called, I'm not sure what the acronym is, but basically they're just set there by the computer. They're like the rocks and the mountains and the trees, you know, they're just there. And if you come up and bump one, it may give you a message, but anybody bumps it anytime always gets the same message. It's not really a conscious entity. It doesn't make choices. It just interacts. Well, you have those kinds of things too. So we look at the rocks, and we look at those things that are not conscious. And everything alive isn't necessarily conscious. The trees aren't conscious in that sense. Conscious means makes decisions, makes choices. Oh, I can do this, this, or that. I'm going to do that. You know, that's my decision space, and I'll make those choices. So we get down to a level of critters that live in the deep blue sea, and the choices that they make don't affect us. So they're 5 miles down where there is no sunlight, and there's things down there that are alive, and no doubt things down there that are conscious that make choices. But it doesn't affect us. So unless you are in a shared reality frame, it doesn't really matter. Okay, there may or may not be aliens living, you know, the fifth sun over in the next galaxy. Doesn't matter. As long as there's no connection between us, then it's irrelevant to us. So all consciousness doesn't necessarily count in your little world. Your world only deals with those things that are conscious in your world and the non-conscious players that are there, like the rocks and the trees. So you interact with that. It's all virtual. To understand it, it really is very similar to the virtual reality game. So if you've ever played these virtual reality games, it works very much like that. When you are in those games, characters can wander in and out. They can interact with you. Most of them are people with a mouse in their hands and staring at a monitor somewhere in their home, somewhere in the world, and you just interact. And when those people are not where you can interact with them, their existence is irrelevant to you. So when you walk into the tree, or when you walk into the woods, you see the tree, and the tree has squirrels and bugs in it and all sorts of things, then it has to be consistent for all of them, all the entities and all of the history of that. You get what's probable, but that probability has to suit everyone. Does that help any? It doesn't look like it helped much. I still, you know, I can't see real well. You're kind of dark in my picture, but I didn't see any lights come on there in the eyes. You still have a problem with something.
No, it does help a bit. It's I think it's just a hard thing for me to wrap my mind around in terms of
I have a particular personal connection to this just because all of my artwork is nature-based, and while I tend to be fairly flexible in my belief systems and kind of accepting of new ways of looking at things, and more with every passing year, I notice everything is starting to sound the same, and I mean that in the best possible way, you know, that it's all, you know, kind of clicking into one big picture for me. But this particular element of the, trying to think of some speck of, you know, some patch of dirt in the middle of the Nevada desert where there are, let's just say, no insects, no nothing, you know, it's just dirt. Does that, like, what is its existence if I'm not there and if nobody else is there to witness it, you know, with the issue aside of whether or not, you know, we consider trees to be conscious or algae to be conscious.
Well, it's like this.
Or, you know.
You have to realize that reality exists in a data stream. It exists in your mind. It's only what you see. Now, when here's another. You talk about the dirt in the middle of the desert and there's nobody around. Well, let's talk about a tree growing in a park and everybody goes to bed. You know, there's nobody staying up watching that tree. And let's say there are no bugs and anything else around either. So what happens? You know, people say, well, what do you mean? So when everybody goes to sleep, the tree disappears? And it's like, no, the tree was never there in the first place. The tree doesn't disappear. You see, the tree was only data fed into your mind. It was just, you see the tree when you look at the tree. If you don't look at the tree, you don't see the tree. When you're in a virtual reality game, if you look at the mountains, you'll see the mountains. If you don't look at them, they're not rendered to you. Here you are on your computer and you've got your mouse and you're looking at your screen and you're looking away from the mountains. The mountains are not rendered on your screen because you're not looking at them. It's not that, oh, the mountains were there and now they went away. You know, it's that sort of thing. The mountains are just potential mountains and you only see them when you look at them. So if you have dirt in the middle of Nevada and nobody's looking at it, it's not being rendered to anybody. That doesn't mean the dirt disappears in Nevada. The dirt was never in Nevada in the first place. Nevada was never in Nevada in the first place, you see. It's all just data in your mind. It's all data, and we are sharing this data. So if you look at it at the virtual reality game, and here you are in the virtual reality, and you turn and you look someplace, and there's something over there. Suddenly, what you're looking at gets rendered to you. It's another being. It's a tree. It's a horse with wings, whatever. It gets rendered to you. And because it gets rendered to you, you can see it. And somebody else turns and looks, and they can see it too. And you both can talk about it because you both can see it. Or you both remember it, you can talk about it. That's data in your mind. It's not that when you don't look, the trees go away and the dirt disappears and nobody lives in Nevada, there'd be a great black hole there. You know, Nevada doesn't exist. Physical reality is just an illusion. It's just data and information. And each one of us lives in our own reality, though it's shared. It's a shared game, just like, you know, The Sims is a shared game. But there's no point in The Sims rendering houses and lawns and all the stuff that's in Sims if there's nobody playing. If, let's say, everybody left the server and there was nobody playing, would the server just go on rendering all these trees and swimming pools and people? And no, it wouldn't do that. It just sits there until somebody gets in the game and says, oh, what's over there? Then the computer renders what's over there. It's not that this stuff, you know, it's your habit of thinking. You think of our physical reality as solid, substantial stuff that's always there. It exists fundamentally. And if you start with that as an assumption, then virtual reality will never make sense. But if you start with that as it's just data that you see, and it's not that when everybody goes to bed at night, the trees in the park all disappear. It's just the trees in the park never existed in the first place. Neither did the park, neither did the houses that they're in, none of it. It's just data they're getting. And either the data is given to them so that they can interact with it, or the data isn't given to them. It's not that there's something physical that truly exists by itself and somehow it disappears and comes back whether you look at it or not. That's a conflict between two things. You're having an assumption that things have independent physical existence, and then you're trying to overlay a virtual reality on top of that assumption, and you get conflict. It doesn't make sense. So that's the problem. You need to let that assumption go that physical things exist. it's all just information to consciousness. There's a bunch of consciousness. There's a bunch of people with a mouse in their hands and a computer screen. And all of these people are playing a virtual reality game with each other. It's that sort of thing. And it's not about, well, if all the players look to the west, you know, do the mountains disappear? Well, the mountains were never there. They were just, the mountains are data that gets sent to the computers of those individual people when they look that way. When they don't look that way, the mountains aren't there. It's not that the mountains were there and then they disappear. The mountains were never there. They're just data that gets sent to people when they look at a particular position. So it's, the reason it's hard to get is you have habits of thinking. We all do. And it's not just you. Everybody struggles with this virtual reality thing. It's not a simple concept. And that's because we have these ingrained assumptions and attitudes and beliefs about the way the world worked. And this just conflicts with those. And it's hard to not think of them in the way that you, you know, are kind of programmed to think of them. So it's a very difficult thing to do. Yeah, it's not a, if I don't look, it goes away. If you don't look, it's not, the data isn't sent to you. If you do look, the data is sent to you. Nothing goes away or comes back. It's just whether data is sent to you or not sent to you is the thing. So a computer in a virtual reality would never waste cycles just rendering things that, you know, for no reason. It only renders things when somebody's looking, when somebody needs the data. Matter of fact, that's how it gets rendered. A call goes out and says, I need to see what's over here. And then the data then gets generated and sent back to you, the, you know, the consciousness. So does that help?
Yeah, it does. You know, I thought that I had understood the virtual reality thing pretty, like, maybe a little too easily when I was listening
it's a
to
tough
your talks,
concept.
So that I suspected that I was maybe not fully grasping something. Yeah. But I can see that there's a few more steps towards turning to that other perspective that will be a little more challenging. But that does help, actually.
Yeah, okay.
So thank
Good.
You.
Good.
Yeah, thank you.
Good. Yeah, you're welcome, Robin.
Hi, Tom. I'm Kari.
Hi, Kari.
In relationship to that previous question, and you were talking about rendering reality, it made me think of a conversation I had recently with my brother, and he was telling me about his topology class that he took in college and how these equations prove that these shapes exist in five or more dimensions. However, they cannot be rendered. So topology is a reality, but there's an element of belief there. So I just thought I'd ask for comments on that.
Yeah. Well, you know, in mathematics, you can have n dimensions, right? You can have a matrix like a vector field. You know, you think of a vector, right? Three dimensions, x, y, and z. Well, you can have one that's 10 or 20 or 100 different dimensions, and that's defined mathematically. All the dimensions are orthogonal to each other. That doesn't make sense. We can't show that in a 3D reality because, you know, we can only show 1D, 2D, and 3D. You know, once you go up above it, you know, we're done. So that's all that we can show. But these things exist, and it's for the same reason. They exist because the data can be computed that tells you what they do. So you can look at that topology, and the data can be computed that tells you that, you know, there's a lump over here in dimension 4 and a valley over there in dimension 5 and so on. And mathematicians have you know, used that sort of thing, for probably, I don't know, I guess it was about 50 years ago that got to be a real big deal in mathematics, you know, going beyond dimensions. And the reason it got to be a big deal is because it was about 50 years ago that computers got to be, you know, fast enough that became something that you could work with. So, yes, reality then gets reduced to a data stream, doesn't it? It's just data. It's not really that you have to believe that it exists. The data will show you what goes on there in that fifth or sixth dimension and how it's working and what it does, but you can't draw a picture of it. You can't make a model of it. You can't sculpt it because you can only do that in 1, 2, and 3 dimensions. Actually, you can't even do it in 1 and 2. you can only approximate it in one or two. You can't make something infinitely thin, right, to make it in two dimensions. It always is going to have some thickness to it. So you can only work in three dimensions. You can approximate one and two, but you can't even approximate number four or five or six or 20. They're just like, it's just data, you know, and that's the way mathematicians deal with it. Yeah, they can work with n-dimensional structures, and it's just information. Well, see, here we are, and it's the same sort of thing. Here we are, consciousness. We're getting data according to a rule set, and that rule set evolved to be this reality frame, so it ends up, three-dimensional data, basically. But you can slip out of that virtual reality into the larger consciousness, and then you're not restricted to three dimensions. Then you're in this place where there is no separation between anything, you see, because distance isn't defined. Distance is a one, two, or three-dimension issue. You know, once you go outside of three, distance is not defined anymore. So things aren't separated by distance. It's just that concept goes away. If you want to be someplace or talk to someone or see something, you just intend it and you're there, just like that. You don't have to travel. It's all instantaneous. So you can experience in a different, larger dimensional reality frame, but the experience is not like the experience here. It's totally unique. So it's not, a lot of people have this idea when you get to the larger reality, it's just like this reality, only weirder. You know, well, it's not at all like this reality. It's just weirder. It's just unique. It's different. So, yeah, it's a very good idea. It's a very good concept. I'll use that from now on when people can't quite get the idea that this three-dimensional reality is just a data stream. You know, I'll bring up the fact that mathematicians work with n-dimensional realities and can use them, and they're just data streams.
Yeah, my brother said, I wish you could draw the...
Yeah, right. No, you can't.
I wish you could, illustrate some of these equations that he finds so fascinating.
Right, and a great book for giving you an appreciation for not being able to experience or not being able to draw or get visual pictures outside your own reality frame is Flatland. It's an old book. And if you read Flatland, by the time you get to the end of it, you'll really appreciate the difficulty in visualizing outside of your own reality frame. In our case, outside of 3D.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, thank you.
You're welcome.
Hi, Tom.
Hello.
Hello. I'm Justin.
Oh. Justin?
How you doing?
Okay. Well, thanks for putting us all together, by the way. Doing the
thank you.
Doing the legwork and kindling the interest.
Oh, definitely.
And,
my pleasure.
And then doing the technical part. Appreciate that. Thank you.
You're welcome. Thank you. I have a question for you that relates to exploring the larger reality, and specifically with meditation and out-of-body experiences and sleep paralysis and all those sort of states.
Mm-hmm.
And my question is about the transition between this data stream and that data stream. Is it common that there's the my interpretation of some of the experiences is that it's a blend of the two that I almost kind of get hung up on, and I'm trying to decide which strange things that I'm hearing and seeing I should latch onto. Is it, you know, part of my brain reacting in the state that it's in and the hypnagogic hallucinations, or is it coming from the larger reality data stream? I can never distinguish, I guess, is what I'm saying.
Yep. Your problem there is it's difficult for you to, you kind of, when you go to a different reality frame, like you're doing, and you're making this transition, you somehow want to define this other reality frame that you're going to. I mean, how do you define it? Well, guess what? The only way you can define anything is in terms of your own experience. So you want to define it in terms of three-dimensional reality, just like this one. You know, you want to hear something, see something. You want to see something move. You know, it, it you define that other reality in terms of this reality. And as soon as you do that, of course, then it confuses you, because then that reality looks like this reality. And am I just making that up? Because that reality shouldn't be like this reality. And you see, you get all wadded up in a knot. And at that point, you're confused, and that blows the whole experience. So what you have to do is to get rid of expectation. Don't have any expectation about what you're going to experience. Don't put any faces on it. Don't dress it up in any 3D language or experiences. Just be open. Now, you still are going to interpret things in terms of your 3D senses. You know, you're going to see things and hear things when you really don't have eyes or ears, because you're not in your, you know, you're not really physical, but that's how you will interpret them. Realize that you're only going to get metaphors and symbols that will translate back to thoughts and language, which are constricted for you because you're a 3D, you know, you're launching here from a 3D reality. You're going to be constricted to that 3D reality. But a lot of people have problems with the transition because they try to understand it. They want to categorize it. They want to, I don't know, they want to analyze it as they go. And all of that analyzation, oh, what am I doing now? Well, what does this mean? You know, and oh, this is a little different. Should I do that? You see, they're sitting there with their mind jabbering about all this analysis that's trying to assess what's going on. And of course, they're assessing it all in terms of what they know, which is physical reality. And it gets very, very confusing. If you let your expectations go to where you have no idea what you're going to experience, but it'll be an experience of some sort, go. Have the experience. Now your problem is not that you couldn't have the experience because you couldn't get through the transition. Now your problem is going to be, was that real? You see? Now your problem is, was that real or was I just making that up? Well, the only way you can get over that is to just keep doing it. Go with it. If you're talking with a non-physical being, if you're going to a particular kind of thing where you get certain imagery, go there enough times and see if you can't find something there that's evidential, you know, something that you can come back and check. And if you can't, then it's probably not a good thing for you to do as a beginner, because as a beginner, what you want to do is gain confidence. So you want to find things that are evidential so you can check them. After a while, once you understand what you're doing and you have confidence, you won't need to check everything so much. You know, you'll just go and you'll know because of how it is and how it feels and so on that you're doing it. Now that you don't know, so you do things like healing, you do things like remote viewing, like was in that the video on Sunday. You do those kinds of things because they're evidential, and in that sense, it's a good way to start. So have no expectations, just experience. Don't worry about whether you're making it up or not. Eventually, you will have to worry about that. You know, eventually, that is a question you need to ask. It's not that you never ask that question of, am I making it up or not, but you don't ask it too soon. Most people start asking it the moment they start experiencing it. They start asking those questions in the transition to it, you see, and that's a problem. So if you experience it, let's say you're talking to some entity and you're getting some sort of communication back, and you right away are thinking, am I making this up? That will cause problems. Just relate to that entity 3 or 4 months later, after you've had 50 conversations. Now you have enough information to decide, are you making it up or not? If there's nothing in it that is absolutely certain in your mind that was something that, you know, wasn't in you, you know, it's just foreign information, or they're telling you things that you can evidentially go check, then you can check that. Otherwise, you may get ideas and things that just aren't part of your reality. And you'll know that, because it's like, well, where did that come from? You know, that's nothing I ever would have thought. Then eventually, with experience, then you can go back and start to experiment around that thing that you know was outside of you and work with that. So it all takes time, is what I'm saying. 6 months later, you may be able to make that decision whether you're making it all up or not. But if you try to make that decision as you go, you'll probably never get there.
Wow, thank you. Yeah. I appreciate it.
Yeah, you're welcome.
Hi, Tom.
Hello. I take it.
My name is Chris.
Chris, okay, not Robin. Chris.
Not Robin.
Okay.
Chris. Hi. Okay, So my question is about, okay, so when I was in my later teens, I did a lot of meditating and yoga, and was reading a lot of metaphysical things, and I started to really disassociate from my little c, mm-hmm. And become really absorbed into this bigger c, in this larger reality. And there was a period of about 3 months where I was just really absorbed in that, and I think I was kind of neglecting my little c, mm-hmm. and for whatever reason, I sort of stopped being able to access those states of consciousness, and sort of came back from that, and that was a really difficult time. But ever since then, I've been kind of forced to pay more attention to my little c. And my question is, my question is, can you say more about what you mean by grow up, when you say grow up, and how do we develop? Sure. What does that look like?
Sure. Yeah, the reason that it got harder for you to stay in the larger sea is because you were becoming unbalanced, and it was not good. You're here for a reason, and you need to stay balanced. You can spend a fair amount of time in the larger consciousness system if you're really focused in, you know, little c as well. But if you're only focused in one and not so focused in the other, you get out of balance, and pretty soon you're losing your ability to grow up, which gets us back to grow up. What grow up means, it's a, you know, we can use a synonym for that. Grow up, lower your entropy. If you heard me talk about entropy, raise the quality of your consciousness. It's evolving the quality of your consciousness. So it has to do with you as a consciousness, as a big C consciousness, evolving. And you're evolving toward becoming love. That's love is a low entropy consciousness. So you're lowering your entropy, you're raising your quality. You could call it spiritual growth. You know, there's lots of different things you could call it. People from different from different focuses have different words for it. But I just call it growing up. You're becoming. You're learning. You're getting rid of ego. You're getting rid of fear. You're getting rid of beliefs and expectations and all that stuff. You're just living in the moment. Okay, so that's what growing up is. So you could say that growing up is getting rid of fear. You know, that would be another way of saying it, getting rid of ego. It's becoming a whole person at the being level. That would be another way. You have two different levels you operate on, the intellectual level and the being level. You can get unbalanced by you live only out of your head, and you're only in the intellectual level. You know, a lot of intellectuals get in that bag where they live out of their heads, and they have a very rich intellectual life, but inside at a deeper level, you know, they're impoverished. They don't have much in there, you know, and it's that being level that you artists talk to. That's what you're interacting with. You're not interacting with somebody's intellectual level. If you're doing that, then your art's not really communicating, right? That's when the person looks at it and says, oh, is that a duck or is that a swan? You know, and they're real, you know, they want to intellectually, you know, make all the piece parts mean something they're used to, you know, and that's not really what you're trying to get. You're trying to communicate at a being level, not at an intellectual level most of the time. So anyway, that's what the growing up means. It's getting rid of fear. And balance is important, because if you stay in that big C, if you stay in that meditation so much that you kind of forget and neglect what's going on here, then you're losing your opportunities. You're losing your abilities to make those choices and to grow up. And the larger conscious system will just turn down the gain. And until you can stay balanced, they may not turn the game back up again, you know. So that's what was going on there, and that's what growing up means. So as you grow up, and that's another thing, you know, people say, well, I sure would like to go out of body, and I'd like to do all these things, and I'd like to, you know, be able to travel around in a larger consciousness system. But really, it's not about that. It's about growing up. It's about getting rid of fear, having a higher, you know, evolving the quality of your consciousness. That's what it's about. And if you raise the quality of your consciousness, then all these other things, the out-of-body and the healing, that get real easy. They get trivial to do. They're not so hard. But if you haven't raised the quality of your consciousness, then learning to get out-of-body and other things is a struggle. You know, it's a real hard thing to do. But that's because you're getting a cart in front of the horse. You need to keep the horse in front of the cart because it works better that way. So growing up is the thing you really should be focused on. And then, you know, surfing the larger consciousness system, you know, is just something that comes as an ability and a thing you can do as you increase your quality of consciousness and get a bigger picture. So it's much better to take it that way. You kind of had the cart out in front of the horse, and that's why it didn't work. It wasn't working so well.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Hi, Tom. I'm Ala.
You're who?
Ala.
Paula?
Ala.
Ala.
A-L-A, yes.
Uh-huh. Like Ala La. Ala
La La La, yes. A palindrome. You can read it both ways from. It's a round name. So I have a question for you, although it's more of a confusion on my part. It's still very difficult for me to grasp this whole concept because, you know, I'm used to thinking in linear terms, like everything has a beginning, the progression, the end. So you're referring to this growth, to this spiritual growth, as something as an end of and a good of its own, or is it a tool for something else? So in other words, is there a purpose for this growth, or is it irrelevant?
Yes. Yes, there is a purpose for this growth, but you may be thinking of an endpoint. Is there an endpoint? You know, is there a goal? The growth is its own reason. In other words, evolution is an open-ended thing. If you think of even biological evolution, it's not that one-celled or that 10-celled thing said, "Oh, one day I'm going to become a horse." You know, it didn't have a goal. Or I'm going to become a fish, and then when I'm a fish, I'm going to grow legs. Not that it had a goal. It's just open-ended. It just happens and becomes whatever it becomes. That's the way this is. Your consciousness, you're part of a consciousness system that's just evolving. So what do? We evolve. That evolution in consciousness means lowering entropy, growing up, you know, becoming love, that sort of thing, because that is most productive. Consciousness is it's kind of a social thing in a sense. You know, consciousness interacts. Consciousness isn't just a unit of consciousness all by itself isolated. That didn't grow much. That's why we're all here, because consciousness then, you know, divided as cells divided because they found that they could get more done. They had lower entropy if they all cooperated with each other, and you had the locomotion part and the feeding part and the digestion part and, you know, all these various parts. So the cells divide, they make up a more complicated, which is lower entropy, more order thing. Well, that's the way it is. Consciousness does the same thing that the biological things did. So as it becomes more ordered, it moves toward more to being love. That's the way consciousness interacts. Interactions between units of consciousness are optimized. The interaction's optimized if the interaction's based on love. Then that would make sense, right? You have interaction between two people based on fear and hate, and the interaction isn't going to be very satisfying, right? It's going to be destructive. One's going to try to, you know, hurt the other one or take the other one's stuff or whatever, if it's that kind of thing. So interactions between units of consciousness are optimized if they're based on love. That's kind of obvious. You know, that's the way relationships are, right? Relationships based on love are good relationships. Relationships based on fear are terrible relationships. So you have a thing, this digital information field, which has subdivided just like cells did so that it could interact, because that's more complex, it's more structure, therefore lower entropy, and it makes it more functional that way. And it's just evolving. So there isn't an end point other than the fact that it's just evolving the way it does, and it goes and becomes whatever it does. So evolution is an open-ended process that doesn't necessarily have a specific goal. Now, some people in some of the Eastern traditions have the idea that, well, you know, you grow up, you become enlightened, and after that, you know, you're at the end. You know, what else can you do? You're already enlightened. You know everything. You're as wise as anybody gets, and you're done. Well, then what? You know, what do you do when you're done? You know, sit on the cloud, play a harp, right? That's our Western view of what you do when you're done. You know, what do you really do when you're done? Well, the fact is, this is evolution. You're never done. You're just evolving. You know, when that 20 or 50 celled thing says, oh, when I become a fish, I'm done. You know, well, that's small thinking. That's because the fish is as big a picture as it could possibly imagine. So here it is, and it's maybe a jellyfish, and it wants fins and whatever. It wants to be able to move. So it says, when I get to be a fish, I'm done. Well, it's because it has a very small worldview. Well, if you don't have a small worldview, there is nothing. You're never done. Are we done now that humans have evolved? Are we done? No. It's just part of a process. It's still going on. You know, what's going to happen in the next 20 million years or 100 million years? Well, hard to say. It's an ongoing, open-ended process. So there is no, I'm done in this process. You just keep evolving, because there's always ways that you can put the bits together that's more profitable than the ways that you have them. There's always ways of interacting. Now, if you just had one thing that was interacting with itself, it may get to the point that it was done. You see, because that's not very efficient. There's only a finite number of ways. But now you have billions, trillions of things that are all interacting with each other. Now you have 10 to the 100th power or something possibilities. You're never done. There's all sorts of ways these things can go together. At least they keep us busy for a very, very long time. As far as the practical sense of it goes, from the more of an Eastern viewpoint, you know, you come here and you try to get rid of fear and ego to where your life is just gets a little sane, you know, and you're not so crazy and you're not so miserable. So you work on that first. When you get to that point, then the next thing you do is you come back here and you try to help other people get a little more sane. You know, you become a teacher and a helper, and you get past that point and you become maybe a better helper, you know, and you can work on that thing for a long time. There are things that you can do that you don't even end up having to come to a physical reality for, where you can work. See, the physical reality is not the only game in town. It's not the only reality frame in which things grow. This is just this one, you know, and there's other physical reality frames, and there's other things going on that aren't in physical frames. They're just not as immediate, and you don't learn as quickly as you do in a physical frame. You know, it's like in the beginning, when you're young, when you're 3 years old, think how fast you learn things. Or when you're a newborn, when you're 1 year old, think how fast you learn things. I mean, you learn language. And if you're in a bilingual home, you learn two languages. And you learn to walk, and you learn to talk, you learn to eat, you learn to chew, you learn to do all kinds of amazing things. And you're constantly picking up relationship information and cultural information. And you're just growing really, really fast. Now, what about if you're 90 years old? How fast are you growing? Are you just every day it's like something new and you're a bigger and better? No, it doesn't get that way. You see, you get older and the rate of growth gets slower and slower and slower and slower, sort of thing. So here we are. We're just infants in this consciousness process. We're just young. We're toddlers, you see. We're in daycare here. So we're in this physical reality because this is the fast track for the kids in daycare. This is the fast track where you have all this immediate feedback. So that's kind of why we're here. And it looks like there should be a goal and an endpoint, but there really isn't. And particularly from the view we have here, it would be like that amoeba knowing that if it ever became a fish, it'd be done. You know, our viewpoint is so small from where we are that even conceptualizing an endpoint is kind of silly for us to do because our vision is so small. So I'd say that the best thing to do as far as your thinking about it goes and your confusion is that there are no endpoints. Evolution is an open-ended process that just continues to go. Now, we can hypothesize and we can make up stuff, and I do that in my books. I say, well, you know, what if? What if all the bits, you know, it's a finite system. What if all the bits get configured as, you know, as efficiently as possible? Then what? Well, there's sorts of things you could do. Maybe somebody hits a reset button. You know, maybe you upload all the low entropy knowledge or something, and then start over. Maybe you take your least productive bits and delete whatever's in them, you know, and just keep your most productive. And who knows? But now we're just making stuff up. You see, now we're that jellyfish thinking about it could fish, and maybe it could be a Tyrannosaurus Rex, and maybe it might even be a person, you know, and it's just making stuff up. It has no idea whether that's really there or not. So we have to do that with some humor because we don't really know. But a digital system has lots of options. It's not like a physical system. Digital systems are extremely flexible. So we don't really know. Because it's a finite system, there may be a kind of an endpoint, but it's certainly not within our grasp to imagine what it is.
Well, thank you so much.
You're welcome.
It's Regina again.
Hi, Regina.
Could you address the idea of being surprised by something? If the tree doesn't exist, mm-hmm. How do I stumble over a branch that's on the ground? You know what I'm saying?
Well, the tree does exist as probability. It's not that the tree doesn't exist. It doesn't exist as a physical objective thing. It exists as data. If there is a tree, okay, and you're not looking, let's say you're walking through the woods and you're not looking down, okay? So as you walk through the woods and you're not looking down, but your foot snags on a root and you fall over anyway, and you're thinking, well, I wasn't looking down. Why was that root there? Well, the root was there because there was a tree there. Trees have roots, and there's a probability that if this tree has roots, some of them are poking up above the ground because it's a willow oak, and their roots tend to poke up above the ground a lot. So that's the probability. Now, it goes up into where the data streams are created. There's this various possibilities. There could be no root there, or maybe there's a root there, whatever. They look at, well, is it a willow oak, and da-da-da, what's the ground like? Is it rocky underneath, which would push the roots up? Da-da-da, and it goes through all the probabilities, and here are 50 different things that could happen to you when you took that step, and you reach up and randomly pull one of them out based on the probability of them happening. You know, you're pulling a random pull from a distribution, and sure enough, you pull out the, I trip on a root, and that's what happens. And then, of course, when you look down, you see the root, and it's there, and, you know, your knees are skinned up, and so on. All the rest of the rule set things happen. So that's why if you don't look down, you still may trip over a root. It's just because it's probable that it would be there. If it's probable, then you make a random draw. Something can happen. You see, so it's not that you make things appear and disappear by your attention. It's just that your attention will say what gets given to you in your data stream, but it's all not just visual. You know, it's not your data stream isn't just visual information. It's your whole reality that you're interacting with. So it could have been that you made that step and you didn't trip over a root. And that maybe was equally probable that you did trip over a root, if it was a 50-50 probability that a root would be there. So you may not have tripped there, or you might. It just depends on how it happens to come out. And that's all just done kind of random draw amongst the possibilities. Now, use your intent to modify future probability. And you could say, I'm going through this woods, and I know there are roots, but I don't want to trip on any of them. I don't want any roots to happen to be right where I put my feet, even though it's midnight and I can't see anything. You know, I know where the path is, but I can't see my feet. but I don't want to trip over a root. And if you focus your intent on that, and if you have an ability to focus your intent very well, you will lower the probability that you will trip on a root because you've just modified future probability. On the other hand, if you're taking that same walk and you say, oh my God, I know I'm going to fall on my face, it's dark, you know, I'm going to trip on something, you know, and it's a big, it's an issue for you, then that will increase the probability that you will indeed trip on a root and fall on your face. So you modify this reality as you go. You modify the probabilities, and what you interact with just comes out of the probabilities from the rule set of what's likely to happen. So you're not going to, you know, walk through a woods that's probably full of lumpy things because it's all willow oaks and they happen to put roots above ground a lot. You're probably not just going to walk through there and never notice a root unless you really have good focus and you can really make that reality happen, because the probability otherwise would be that sooner or later you're going to stumble on a rock or a root or something else if the ground is rough instead of the ground being smooth. Does that help?
Do you believe that we can be surprised then?
Oh, of course we can be surprised. A lot of the stuff that happens when you trip over that root, you're surprised. It doesn't mean that you don't, you know, there's nothing that says that you have to know everything that's going to happen to you. Of course you can be surprised. If you walk through the woods and you happen to take a random draw and a root ends up right in front of your toe, then surprise, you know, you stumble. There's lots of things that happen to you that are surprising. Surely you can be surprised all the time. That's because you're not in control. A lot of these random draws have to do with what you're doing. You're moving. You're picking up a foot and you're moving it in front of you because you're walking. Well, every time you do that, there's some possibility that there'll be a stone, a brick, somebody left a cement block laying in the path. There's all these possibilities. And if you can't see, if you're not staring at your feet, then you will probably be surprised. It's also possible there's nothing there. It's a perfectly smooth path. Nobody left a brick. But that's what, let's say the probability of a brick is 1 in 100. Well, you take a random draw, the chances of getting 1 in 100, not likely, but one day you may be walking out on that path, and because somebody was building a wall there using bricks, the probability now goes up, and there you go. So surely you can be surprised. Life is not deterministic. You have free will. And it's not like that everything is planned. It's not. There's lots of randomness in our reality. There's lots of room for multiple choices. In other words, whether or not you trip or whether or not the person walks into the woods and sees a dead tree, that's, you know, there might have been 100 different views of that woods that would have met all of the constraints. So randomly, they just pick one. One of them gets picked if they were all of equal probability. And here's one that had a dead tree in it. Well, that's the one that got picked. Here's one that didn't. Well, maybe that one would have been picked. You see, so the woods isn't a fixed physical thing that's always like that. See, it's the same problem. Once you assume that it's fixed and objective, then you have this issue. If you figure it's not defined until you get the data stream, after that, it's going to be defined because now it's in this reality, has to stay in this reality. It's part of the history database now. So you can't have a smooth path one day and a lumpy path, you know, another day. You can't go outside this room that you're in now and find, you know, that you're in the middle of Kansas. You know, that won't work. It's not consistent with history. So things have to stay consistent. But once things are in your data stream, once you're in that video game and you're in the World of Warcraft and you turn around and there's a mountain to the right, well, there's always going to be a mountain to the right there. You're not going to look at from that exact same point, look at that same direction, and there's a desert the next day. See, that won't happen. It's consistent. So once they plant a mountain someplace, then it stays there. It's the same here.
Okay. Thanks.
Thanks. Did that mean you're going to give up?
Okay, here's the next question.
Okay. Okay, so now in this scenario, there's two people walking down the road mm-hmm. with their eyes closed.
Mm-hmm. Taking chances.
Two different people. Mm-hmm. And with no anticipation of what is in front of them, right? There's no anticipation, like you were talking to Justin. He's mm-hmm. anticipating right. what he's experiencing in this. Okay, I'm not even sure I know how to express all what it's going through my mind. Okay, let's go back to the route again. There's two people walking down, and they both trip. Mm-hmm. And they have their eyes closed. And they weren't even talking about it or anticipating
right.
the route, and
right.
they
well,
both
they would,
trip.
They would likely both trip or not, in a sense, in that if the probability... See, they're going to experience... Their experience has to be connected because they're there together. There they are walking, they're holding hands, you know, they're in the same place. One of them isn't going to walk into a wall and the other one not. You see, if there's a wall there, unless, of course, there would just happen to be a doorway and one hit the wall and another one through the doorway, but chances are that their experience is going to have to be similar. Otherwise, it wouldn't be consistent. One of them couldn't be snowing and the other one, you know, be, you know, 100 degrees out. They have to have a consistent experience. So if one of them trips, then that other one might too, if the route went across the whole path and not just across half the path. One of them might just trip by themselves. Both of them might trip. But whatever it is, one of them's not going to find flat, smooth path to walk on, and the other's walking on, you know, real lumpy paths. They are walking just any which way, not necessarily on a path. What they run into has to be consistent with the two of them being together. They can't have two totally separate experiences.
I guess I keep going back to the idea that you said that the tree doesn't exist unless I perceive the tree.
It doesn't exist for you unless you perceive the tree. If somebody else is looking at the tree, it exists for them. They're getting the tree rendered into their data stream renders a tree for them, but you're not. You have your back toward the tree. Tree doesn't exist for you. It exists for them. You turn around, now you'll see the same tree they see because you're together looking at the same thing.
What if I back into the
tree?
Yeah,
if you back into the tree, you'll back right into the tree they're looking at because you're sharing this part of reality is a shared reality. You're not in it just by yourself, and it has to stay consistent among all the players. So if you're backing up and you back into the tree they're looking at, they'll say, "What's that woman doing backing into that tree?"
And backing into my tree.
Yeah, and you'll just back into the tree because the tree is there because there's somebody there who sees it and it's there. Now, if you're backing up in a woods that nobody's ever been in before, whether you bump into a tree or not, becomes now, the probability now is maybe equal that there is one or there isn't one there. But when you have another person sitting there looking at it, now the probability that there is one there is one because it's been rendered there and you're backing into it. If there's nobody else around, then, and it's a, you know, it's a place you've never been, whether there's a tree behind you or not, could be, maybe so, maybe not, a little random draw. Bang, you know, you either hit it or you don't. Strange, isn't it?
Yeah, I guess I get confused with the whole idea of expectation, surprise, and being able to measure things, what Kari was talking about.
Well, there's lots of surprises. Anyway. Life is very surprising. That's one of the wonderful things about it. If it wasn't, it'd be real boring.
Yeah. Well, thank you.
You're welcome.
Hey there.
Hey.
I'm Angie.
Hi, Angie.
I have just a mild curiosity. So I'm sure you've played Second Life, right?
No.
You don't know what Second Life is?
No.
Very
I'm not for all the talk I talk about video games. The only thing I know about them is I watched my children play them.
Oh, okay. Because I wanted to know what your shared experience avatar looked like, but if you haven't played it.
No. I watch my kids play World of Warcraft. That's why I say that. My boys. And I watch my girls play Sims. But now my boys and girls, my youngest girl now is 25 years old, and the playing video games at home has long since gone away. So all my information's old. You know, I make mistakes. I was talking to one group, and I said, well, what if you were a dark elf and a such and such? And he says, there are no dark elves in that game. You know, and I was confusing some older game that my boy had played. But no, I don't know a whole lot about these games.
Yeah, Second Life tends to be more adults playing, adults that aren't happy with their real life, so they're creating another life. They buy islands and build houses, but I just kind of pictured you being a big flaming eyeball, because you can make any kind of avatar you want. You can have body parts in different parts of your face, so that was just my question.
Hi, Tom. It's Peter again. It's kind of this bordering on sort of a personal question, but I'm just curious, what concepts are you currently struggling with to make peace with, to kind of understand in the way that I think a lot of us are struggling with some of the ideas that you're presenting?
You know, everybody struggles with their ego. Everybody struggles with their expectations, because we live in a society that makes us hard, you know, to do without those things. Makes us hard for us to get rid of those things. Always living in the moment is not, you know, it's a good idea to live in the moment and always be focused in the present, et cetera. But, you know, you do have to write a check to make the mortgage payment on time. And there are things that have to happen that you need to focus on other than just living in the moment. So, you know, it's not quite as simple as it sounds. So we all are kind of get pulled into and are engaged in the everyday stuff of interacting with people. And, you just get to the point where less and less of it is reflecting your ego and your fear and your beliefs and that sort of thing. And more of it is just taking it as it comes and making good choices. So that's a change. But as far as things, ideas and concepts struggling with, I don't know that I'm really struggling with any of them now. You know, some of them are hard to define, and I'm struggling with a way to explain them to people. That's a struggle that I have. We talk about us as consciousness and being a piece of the larger consciousness system. Well, in fact, we just, in my mind, just kind of bubble up, are a part of this larger consciousness system. Okay, and we just bubble up from that system whenever we're needed, you know, whenever it's ready for us to get back in a game or whatever. The guides and other non-physical beings, let's say the guides that we talk with, they're not people sitting out there waiting for us to do something, you know, and it's like reality program for, you know, reality TV program for them. They just pop up out of the larger consciousness system when we need them, and they go away when we don't. But they are like us in a way. We do that too. We pop up and get in this virtual reality game, and then we go. When we're not playing a virtual reality game, what are we? Well, we're just data. We're just history. We're all of the sum of all the choices that we've ever made, but it's just sitting there in data. And if it's not projected in a virtual reality, it doesn't have free will. It's just potential. So we're just potential, you say, until we get into a virtual reality. Now, what do I mean by virtual reality? Well, all the experiential realities, every reality in which you can experience in, is a virtual reality. So when you die in this virtual reality, you end up in another virtual reality, you see. It's not like this is the virtual one and the other one's the real one. The only thing that's real is consciousness. Now, this is almost as hard a concept as virtual reality, right? The people to get their head around, because they think of themselves as an inviolate being, a person, and they don't like this idea that they're just a collection of information. And unless they get in a virtual reality, and then they have free will to act in that virtual reality, but otherwise they're just data. And they want to carry this personality through. They don't want this personality thing to ever go away, because then it's like they die. And it's a very difficult concept to tell people, and it's difficult for people to get their arms around. But when you get rid of enough ego then it doesn't really matter the state in which you exist, whether you're without a free will or not. It's mostly the ego that upsets you when you feel like, well, I'd lose me, you know, and well, it's not just you. You're just here in this body form for this particular experience packet. And after that, that's gone. You see, that's not really you either. You are the consciousness. You're the sum of all the choices and all of the decisions that you've ever made that bring you to this point. All of the entropy you've lost, all of the love you've gained, that's what you are. But you're constantly changing as you experience and go. You know, that keeps changing and moving on and taking different forms. So this concept that we are just a piece of the larger consciousness system, a kind of an interface, and we come and go as needed. Well, needed for what? Well, needed to help the whole system evolve. You see, as we evolve, the whole system evolves. So we're part of that whole system strategy for evolution. And we get used and needed as, you know, we're useful to the system. So what happens to somebody who doesn't grow up? Somebody who grows down, de-evolves, if you will, ends up with more fear and more ego as they go. Well, they aren't a very useful player. It's like the barbarian or dark elf, if such thing exists anymore, that never can get its hit points, you know, above 2 or 3. You know, well, it's not a useful character. It just doesn't play well. So what happens? You don't play it, do you? It just sits there. You never take it out and play that player because it's not doing what you want it to do. It's not helping you, you know, get through the game or get to the things that you want to do. Well, it's the same thing here. So if you don't grow up, if you don't evolve, if you're not a valuable player, then I wouldn't expect that you'd be played. And you're just that packet of data, experience, history, all the things that makes you you, that defines you. And the more useful you are to the system, since as lower your entropy, your ability to grow up, the more often you're going to get played, and the more interest that there'll be in your game, if you will. So these are tough concepts that generally people don't like to hear, and they find them a little upsetting, disquieting, and annoying. So I generally don't say them, but now here I've blabbed them all over to you guys because you asked me, what is it that you're having a real hard time with? I have a hard time with delivering those kinds of concepts to people in a way that they are still smiling after I'm done. They're not going, oh crap, you know, this isn't what I thought, you know, I don't know, I like this, I'm going to quit. You know, well, of course you can't quit. It's not an option. Some people don't like that either. So how do you tell people these kinds of things and make it be an upper rather than a downer? I think the only answer to that is you only tell people don't have much ego. You only tell people who are full of love, and then it sounds fine to them because they're happy with whatever. They're just doing what they do. Life is just great, and they go on and they do it, and all the rest of it can just take care of itself. So if you have that kind of attitude, then you're a happy camper with these things. But if it's, well, what about me? You know, then it's kind of a sobering thing that I don't want to play anymore. So that's tough. That's one of the tougher things I've trying to figure out how to deal with and how to make that that knowledge available without, and making it as acceptable as possible to understand. Another thing I have a hard time with convincing people, and it's kind of similar, and it's another problem of mine, is that people want to, you know, because we're 3D people and we live in this, in a world that runs on process, right? Our process is called, it's a physical process, but it has a, the word escaped me. It's, it has cause and effect, right? There's always a cause for any effect. You can always see the process, the stream of this did this, which came this, which happened, you know, which then made that happen, and so on. So we're in this kind of a process. So when when they look at this larger consciousness system, they immediately want to break it down into some kind of an objective causality process. So we have the larger consciousness system, and then from that, you have the individuated unit of consciousness, and then a piece of that is the free will awareness unit, which then plugs into the little C, and we have all this hierarchy of, you know, oversouls and higher selves and, you know, on and on and on, all this stuff. Well, all that is just metaphors. None of that's real. It's just metaphors. For that matter, the larger consciousness systems, just the metaphor, you know, it's just a word we use. We can't really conceive of it in our brains because our brains can only conceive of things that have an objective causality to them. That's we have to think in terms of objective causality. We can't think in abstract terms unless we clothe those abstract terms in some kind of objective causality. That's why people need higher selves and things. That gives them kind of a process. Well, you start with this, and then you're that, and then you're that, and they see all this process, and that makes them warm and cozy because that's now they have objective process. But then they start getting in arguments. You know, what's the difference between an oversoul and a higher self? And, you know, then they start strangling each other because of their dogmas, and, you know, it gets into a problem that way. So again, it's people need those things. So when I use them, I'll talk about an individuated unit of consciousness, a free will awareness unit, you know, higher selves, oversouls. I'll use those words because people need it in order to produce a model in their minds that they can grasp. If you get rid of those things, then it's too airy. It's too abstract for them to get any kind of a intuitive feeling about it, you see. But as soon as you give them that something they can get the intuitive feeling with, suddenly now they have this stuff as a hierarchy of things that are like that, and it's now a belief. And when you have the beliefs, and then it's, you know, people ask questions, well, if the free will awareness is like this and it's attached like that, well, then how do you get this one? You know, and they have all these structural problems because they're overworking the metaphor. You see, the metaphor is not meant to, you know, to deal with all the inner workings and details of, you know, who passes what data to who, when, and why, and what are the, you know, how many wires does it take? You know, how many angels can stand on the head of a pin? You know, you have all these issues come up once you start making metaphors and pushing them past where they can work. So another problem I have in explaining this to people is I give them metaphors to use, but I need to also give them the idea that they're just metaphors, not wrapped up around the structure and the words. We're really dealing with something that's kind of incomprehensible, you see. It's to us as 3D virtual reality characters. You know, look at the guy that's walking around in Sims, you know. What's his concept of the server that's running his game? Well, that's mysticism, right? I mean, he has no idea. He cannot conceive of the server that's running his game. You know, that dark elf can't conceive of the server that's creating all the things there. It's just outside of their ability to conceive of it because their conception is based on the reality that's local to them, which for us is this virtual physical reality. So we're really talking about something that is extremely difficult to put into our language. Our language doesn't work outside of this reality frame. And it's very difficult to explain things. So you use metaphors, and then, of course, people turn those metaphors into solid facts. And those are the facts now. And what you don't believe in auras, or you don't believe in, chakras and this and that, well, then you just don't know, you know, and we'll have a fight about it. And it's all just metaphors. It's not real. It's ways to help us focus our mind to get a grasp of what it is that we're talking about so that we can feel like we understand it. Trick ourselves into feeling like we understand it, right? But you have to just be open and say, no, it's really more abstract than that. There's just this larger consciousness system metaphor thingy, and it acts like it's digital and informational because that's the way we see that it's acting, and we're just a piece of it, and we interact with it. End of story. Well, that's not very comforting. That's you know, people can't work with that. That's not satisfactory. That's not enough for them to get an intuitive sense of it. So there's another struggle, you know, that's very difficult to explain something to people, because the more you explain it to where they can understand it, the more you lead them down a false path that isn't true. You know, it's like in the old days when they said, well, an atom is like a BB flying around a basketball. You know, that's a hydrogen atom. It has this big nucleus and then has this electron, and it zips around the outside. And people began to believe that that's actually what atoms were like, you know, that they were this hard nucleus and they had the little electrons flying around them. And then, of course, they found out they weren't like that at all. That's just a metaphor. They're not basketballs with BBs flying around them. You see, they're just probability distributions. There is no electron anywhere. There's just a cloud of probability of where the electron might be. You see, at the basic level of matter, it comes back to the truth, which is there isn't any. There is no physical matter. It's just probability distributions, you see. So when we get down at that level, then what we really have here starts to show up. But when we deal with it at the macro level, then we have these metaphors and things that work for us. And as long as we don't get too close to the actual truth. The actual truth is there is no atom. There is no electron. It's all just probability. And you find one when you look at it. It gets rendered to you. If you don't look at it, it's just probability distribution. Guess what? That's the way reality works everywhere. Not just, you know, in the small scale thing. So those are some of the things I struggle with is how to explain and not cause problems at the same time, you know, that I'm explaining. How do you explain this so that people actually get it without giving them information that then they turn into dogma? There's any number of people that, you know, they know about individuated units of consciousness and free will awareness units and a larger conscious system, and they can tell you how all of them are connected, all the wires and, you know, ways data gets passed, and they get very intricate in their designs. And you can go up on YouTube and look up spiritual stuff, and you'll find somebody that'll say there's 168 different levels of, you know, this and that, and they break down into all these very detailed things, and none of that's fundamental. That's all just the metaphors. You get gobs of that, but they'll fight you over you know, the accuracy of it. It's it becomes dogma. So that's another problem that I wrestle. I haven't found any really good ways to do that.
Yeah, I'm not so sure. I feel like you have, actually. Yeah.
I've given you some idea of the difficulty, which makes it easier for you to get it. Yeah, that's...
Sure, yeah, yeah. And I think that, you know, as a teacher, you find that dogma is much easier to convey. Because A leads to B, and B is true, and therefore C, and, you know, all that. It makes sense, and I think that we all want things to make sense, but then when you realize that in the desire to have it all make sense, you construct a lie.
Right.
So I think that's kind of you know, a universal when you know, you're trying to pass something on that really has truth to it. You know, it can't be encapsulated in some dogma, formula, technique, approach, idea, book. You know, those are all containers, and the thing that's trying to be contained is much bigger.
Right. Well, you folks as artists are on the easier end of that, because what you produce doesn't have to make sense. It just has to work. It has to mean something. People have to relate to it, you know, and it has to impart the feeling, the information they get out of it. But it doesn't actually have to make sense. But if you're a scientist like I am and you don't make sense, it's a much bigger problem. So you have to make sense, but not tell a lie at the same time. It's difficult to do.
No, I think that is true, but I think that artists struggle with a whole other spectrum of kind of rule sets that you know, technique being one of them. You know, how do you get yourself so that you can have it work, you know, and make sense and be believable, be convincing. So there's just a lot of hard work involved in getting to that point that, that your reality doesn't stay your reality, that it can actually extend to other people and it can be feasible or convincing or beautiful or moving or somehow have greater impact than just it being self-expression.
Right.
You know, it feels good to push paint around, but to do it with purpose and have it be meaningful for other people is immensely difficult.
Yes, I would agree. Immensely difficult. Who knows what makes those people find meaning? Right? Mm-hmm. How do you quantify that?
Yeah. Good. Yeah. Good. Good point. Yeah. Wow. Well, I'm a little bit concerned about taking up too much of your time here. Is there anybody else that has any questions they would like to pose before before we give Tom a break from us? Do you have a question? Yeah. Perhaps we've got a few more questions if you have the time.
Oh, I have the time.
Very good. Appreciate that.
Hi, Tom. I'm Sandy.
Hi, Sandy.
Hey.
That's a new name. It's the first time you've been up. Took you this long to get the courage?
Well, I was hoping I'd have a chance to get in. But some of the things we talked about, really interested in, and you mentioned helping other people get a little more sane and get rid of fear. And so I've been, I was thinking of where we started at with the brain damage question. And I'm also thinking of like my 86-year-old father who is hard of hearing and living in a lot of fear. So since I've met Justin, he recommended this meditation technique with the tonal meditation.
Binaural
and
beats.
I've been doing that. Yeah, I've been doing that and I have been feeling more at peace and more energized at the same time. And I guess my question, it's a really loaded question, but is there anything really basic as a starting point that we can do to help people get more sane, the people that we love and care about and we interact with?
Yes, there is. And the one thing that you can do that matters most for not only helping yourself get more sane, but helping everybody else around you, your culture, the world, and the rest, is to get yourself sane. Okay, as you get rid of your ego, okay, then you have more to offer everybody else. As you get rid of your fear, you have more to offer everybody else. So you cannot, it's very hard for you to give very much to others if you are full of fear and ego yourself. So let's say you're full of ego, and you go talk to your 86-year-old dad, and he says something that offends you. Oh, and you get upset, and you cry and run out or something. See, that's not very helpful to him, right? But if he says something that's upsetting, like, oh, my dear, what happened to you? You look ugly today or something like that, just because who knows why, right? I mean, he's 86. He ought to be able to say anything he wants. And you need to smile and say, well, Dad, I guess it's just, you know, I got up on the wrong side of the bed today, or da-da-da-da-da, and go on and talk with him, you see. Then you can be helpful to him if you don't react with ego. But it's the same with everything. You know, I once was asked, how do you raise kids in these days? You know, how do you raise children? It's such a scary thing to do, to have these children and have to raise them. And I told them, I said, well, the first thing you do is get your own head put on right, and then do whatever comes naturally, you see? And that just takes care of it. Get rid of your own fear. Get rid of your own ego. And then whatever you do, just do it naturally, and it will be part of the solution rather than part of the problem. What causes you to be part of the problem is your fear and ego. So you get rid of those expectations, the fear, the beliefs, the, you know, the wants, the needs, all that stuff. It's about you. You know, well, what about me? You know, that's not nice for me. If you can let all that go, you will be helpful to everybody you meet, and you will help those other people grow up as well. Because when you are surrounded by someone who is not judging you, who is not, you know, reacting to you with fear and ego, then you feel like you can expand a little, you know, you can let a little more out, you can share a little more because this person is kind of giving you the space to do it. So you can help people who have emotional problems or just people who, you know, have aches and pains, whatever. You can be more helpful to people by getting rid of your own fear and ego than anything that you could actually do with your intellect to them. You know, it's not like your intellect says, oh, well, what you could do is first make them comfortable, you know, then give them some money, tell them a nice story, you know, all these things will make them happy. That's not going to really be of fundamental value to them. It might make them feel better in the short term, but in the long term, it doesn't have any residual value. Well, maybe it does have a little because somebody's been kind to them, and that may have a little residual value. But if you are just, you get rid of your fear and ego, then you will be kind to them. You will listen. You will care. You won't just take up their time telling them about your problems, you know, and what you need. So that's the thing you can do to make yourself the most valuable to everybody else, is get rid of your own fear, ego, beliefs, wants, needs, all that stuff. That's the prime thing. And that's really what you're here for. So, you know, it all works out. You know, that's not a side issue. That's the main game. So just work the main game. And then you might ask, well, how do you do that? And it's not a trivial thing to do, but it's not as hard as you think. Beliefs are very hard to identify because many of them are culturally instilled and they're beyond your intellect to pick them out. Fears are like that too. Often the things that drive you inside, why do you do and act and have the reactions you do? It's because of these fears. They're hard to find. You have lots of fears and beliefs that you don't even know you have. But ego is a lot easier to spot. Ego is more obvious. Ego has to do with you. It's about me. You know, it's about what I want, my needs, my desires. I feel good. You're not being nice to me. It's not what I want. And you find out that if you have a lot of I's in your sentences, particularly if your sentences start with I, capital I, then that's a good sign that maybe you need to work on the ego. So you come to every choice you have, every interaction you have, no matter how trivial it is, you know, how do you, what's your intent? It's not the act that matters. It's the intent. It's the motivation. So somebody says, oh, would you help me? Would you get that box out of the cupboard and bring it over here, please? And if you think, oh, what a bother. I was just going to do something, but I'll do it anyway because they asked, and you go get it and you give them the box. Well, that's the act, but that's different than if somebody says that and you say, well, sure, I'd be glad to help because you just feel like it'd be nice to help. It's not intellectual. It's just you at the being level being helpful because it's not about you, you see. It's not about what you were going to do and now you have to go get the damn box. You know, it's about just being in the present and being helpful and caring about people and so on. Well, the action's the same. Both cases, you got the box and you helped them out. But you see, they're very different motivations, very different approaches. So just keep aware of your intent. What's your intention? And why are you doing what you're doing? And how do you feel about what you're doing? And you will notice, it'll be easy to see how much of your intention is about you and your needs and what you want and what's your convenience and as opposed to other people trying to get you to do what they want at their convenience, you know, the way they want it. And just work on that. Every time you see yourself working out of ego, just say, oops, that's all about me. I need to let that go and see if I can't just, you know, be here in the moment and interact with these people rather than come at it from, well, what's in it for me? So that's how you work. And as you do that, that ego, when you start following, well, why did I act like that? You'll see that it'll lead you almost always to a fear or a belief. Well, the reason I acted like that and I was so anxious to get on, I didn't want to help, was because I'm in a rush. And I'm in a rush because I'm afraid if I don't get such and such a place, this will happen or that will happen. You have this fear built up, or you have a belief that something awful will happen if you don't do this right away or whatever. So it'll lead you to fear and beliefs that you don't know you have, and then you can start putting them away and get it. But it's a slow cumulative process that you pick at over years to uncover this ego, uncover these fears and beliefs. But it's well worth it, because once you get rid of a lot of that junk, guess what? Your life becomes a whole lot more fun, and other people like you a whole lot more, and you like yourself a whole lot more, and there's just a lot of joy in your life. Why? Because it's impossible to find something that isn't, you know, that's a downer. It's almost impossible, because your attitude now is stuff happens and I deal with it. I deal with it with caring, and I deal with it, you know, from the being level, and I'm not always, you know, dealing with everything from the intellect or through the ego, and life just gets so much more pleasant. So it's worth the time to pick at these things and uncover them slowly. So number one, what you do to help the rest of the world, get yourself free of your fear and your ego and expectations and all that junk. And second, how do you do it? Start with ego and just pay attention. Pay attention to why you do and feel the way you do, and then get rid of the stuff that's obviously ego. And don't be disappointed if it comes right back and comes right back and comes right back. It's a long, iterative process. But if you really have an intent to do it, you will succeed, and it'll make a huge difference in your life.
Awesome. I'm so glad I asked you. Thank you so much.
You're
really
welcome.
Appreciate it. I'm going to work on it.
Yeah. It's a life's work. Yeah, it's not something you're going to accomplish next week.
I feel like perhaps we should wrap it up here. That was an amazing, amazing, inspiring answer.
Good place to end then, isn't it?
I believe so. But really, I find that one of the most wonderful things that I'm aware of now is I don't even know how to categorize this experience. I don't know if it was about physics or about love or about art or about communication, and I think that's as it should be.
Yeah, exactly. All of the above.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Yeah, and you've pulled it off. You've really added greatly to our database, I guess you could say. But thank you so much. Really do appreciate it, Tom.
You're quite welcome. It's been a lot of fun.